Okay, so we are talking about again polymorphism. We said that polymorphism is one of the fundamental principles of object-oriented programming, along with abstraction, encapsulation, inheritance. And as we said before, without inheritance, there is no polymorphism. So I like to start with again with our simple hierarchy of shapes. Let's write some code, very simple code, and see what we can do about this hierarchy. Okay? So let's say this is my shape.h. I will try to keep it simple, so I will not use any if-def guards or that kind of stuff, and I will ignore the includes and that kind of stuff. So I'll try to concentrate on the main thing here. Class shape is very simple. And in fact, I will give you the whole implementation maybe, I don't know. If I have a shape, I like to, okay, of course, I should have a constructor, and no parameter constructor doesn't do anything. Okay, so the whole implementation is here. And then maybe a double area, and how would you return an area of a shape? I don't know the shape, so I don't know what to do. So for now, I will just return 0, or maybe I should return -1 so that -1.0. So that whoever reads it understands that there is something wrong with this. I mean, nobody can have an area of 0.1. And what else? Maybe I would have a double perimeter. Okay, again, it will return -1.0. That's it too. Okay, what else? I guess that's going to be it. Okay, maybe a void draw so that I am kind of similar to what the book is doing. Void draw, and I don't know what to do actually. I just an empty function. So this is my whole class shape.h, and I have written this. And let's say this is a file. Shape.cpp. Where is shape.cpp? I don't need the shape.cpp. Maybe I should write the shape.cpp. Here, let me write it again. It's going to be funny because shape.cpp will be include shape.h, and that's it because I have implemented everything in the shape.h file, right? Okay, so can I write something in here, right? Yeah, maybe I should implement something in here. Let me implement a function like the function that I have written before. Yes, I will do it that way. Let's say inside shape.h I have this, the function that I showed you before, a function that returns a total area, and it takes a constant vector of shape pointers, reference, okay, v, so that I will implement this in that shape.cpp, okay. So this is my shape.h, right? This is my shape.h. And in shape.cpp, I will include shape.h. And let's implement this one, let me copy paste it. Okay. And this is my implementation. Implementation is maybe a double temporary at the beginning, it is zero. In a range for loop, auto P V. Tell me what should I write here. T assignment plus. What should I write here? P arrow area. Right? That's it. And return T at the end. Good. Is it readable? Yeah. So the whole thing is here. So, what do I do now? I compile this G++. Maybe write a small, let's say driver.cpp, maybe driver one, huh? Driver1.cpp, right? And then inside driver.cpp, I of course include my shape.h and my main, let's say I have shape objects, I have shape objects S1, S2, S3, and I have a vector of, as I said before, I did not write these includes and that kind of stuff, include vector, include that kind of stuff, so I didn't use the using namespaces, so I am not worried about those kind of details. Vector of shape pointers, my vector, and MV push back S1, MV push back S2, MV push back S3, and then I call C out total area and MV. Okay, so very simple driver code, and this is the whole thing that I have written now. Okay, good.
Should we put this polymorphism function inside the class, or should we make it a global function?
Okay. Well, globals, we don't like the globals, but for the sake of simplicity and educational purposes, I made it global. Later, we will see other functions that uses the polymorphism. The point I am trying to make here is, just a minute. Let's try to. Well, I think this took more than. Let me try to make this like that. Can I? Okay, good. Smaller like this. Okay, good. Okay, so what do I do now? I just say G++, I am compiling it, minus C, shape.cpp, right? That will give me shape.o, right? Then I compile my driver, right? I compile my driver, driver1.cpp, that will give me my driver1.o, and then I link them, okay? Minus o, my exec, shape.o, and driver 1.0, that will give me an executable. And that executable is going to, again, I couldn't write it small enough. That executable is going to execute, and as you see, it is not going to give me any meaningful stuff, because in my shape class, I mean, there was not meaningful stuff in it. What's going on? Let's make it smaller and that way. Okay, good. Okay, so there's a compilable and runnable code, right? Compilable and runnable code. But remember what I did before? I said that this is going to be my hierarchy. I can continue and write other functions, other classes, like I can write, for example, a circle, right? Circle.h, and inside the circle.h, I have class circle. Of course, it derives from shape. And class circle is a little bit different. It's constructed as circle. It takes a double, okay? It takes a double r, and it sets my r to underscore r. I am not checking the validity of the radius, okay? And of course, there is a public. And now my area and what else? My area and perimeter are more meaningful now, right? Because I can do them. Let me do it this way. Let me copy them, and I will, after copying them. Okay. So in the private section, I say I have a double R, right? And this one is now more meaningful. My area is going to be 2 times number pi from the math library times number pi. And what am I doing? Where is r? It is just pi and r squared, right? Pi times r times I. And my perimeter is 2 times pi times r. Is that correct? Okay, for the draw, I couldn't do anything because draw requires me some graphics knowledge, graphics libraries, and etc. Suppose I did that too, but I am not going to implement it. Okay, so this is very simple. Circle H actually. I didn't do much, and in fact, let me if this is the circle H, circle.cpp is going to be, that's it. I think just I will include just circle.h. I think that's going to be it for the circle.cpp. Okay. So again, this is my shape.h, shape.cpp, driver 1.cpp. They are all compilable and executable. But after I compiled and executed this stuff, which is not going to give me any meaningful stuff, I have written this one. Now I can say that maybe I can write another driver, driver 2. Let me write a driver 2, okay? Driver 2 is here. Duplicate it. And put it in here. Maybe put it up there. Okay, so this is my driver 2, and driver 2, of course, includes shape.h. Also, it will include what? Include circle .h. By the way, I forgot to include in this one, right? I forgot to include shape.h, right? I should include shape.h in here. Include shape.h, and this is my circle h. Okay. Okay, I am including both shape.h and circle.h. There is a guarding problem that you have seen it, right? There is a problem, but I am not talking about it. So here I have three shape objects, and let me write one more. Okay, I have three shape objects. And let me squeeze some circles in here. Circle C1, 1.0, C2, 7.2, two circles. And inside my MV, I inserted C1 and C2. Nobody has told me that I need to insert their addresses, right? Why you are so quiet today? I should send the addresses of these stuff, not the objects themselves. Come on, and address of it, and I forgot the same thing in here too. Address of S1, address of S2, and address of S3. Okay, so again, this code is compilable. I just compile it. G++ minus C circle dot CPP. And G++ minus C, but what should I write here? Tell me. What am I gonna compile? I am compiling circle.cpp and else. What? No, I already compiled shape. Driver2.cpp. Okay, now I can link them. How do I link them? Minus O executable 2. I do what? shape.all, right? And circle.all, driver2.all. And that will give me another executable. Good. I like to point something here. This seems nice. I have two executables. Okay. I have compiled each file only once. But remember, when this code was compiled, this code did not know anything about circle. Okay. I compiled and ran it, right? I linked it and I ran it. This code did not know anything about the circles. Yet, after I have written this circle header file and the circle implementation, I have written another driver code, and I am calling this total area function, which was written and compiled way before I have written my class, and I expect this to work. How does the compiler know when I say PEP area? How does the compiler know to call an area function that was not written while I am compiling this code? That's kind of confusing, right? That's kind of, it should not happen. Okay, previously, whatever we had written, everything was available and compiler knows which function to call. In this case, since I am calling this total area with the circle objects, but I have compiled this code, and I executed it actually, it's an executable code. I have compiled this code before I have written the shape class. And I can do the same thing with the others too. with the others too, okay? I have written my shape class and I have my total area function. Total area function and shape class are compilable and executable together. But after I have done this, I am writing and compiling other code that derives from the shape, and I expect this total area to work, okay? I mean, regularly this should not, normally this should not work. The things that we know doesn't let us make it work. So we should do something else. The solution is there is a way of doing this. There is a way of doing this. You tell the compiler that this function and this function, you won't know what to call them during the compile time. These functions are virtual functions. Virtual is a C++ keyword. Okay. These functions are virtual functions. And whenever you call them in this way, you cannot know which function to call. Unless you are in the runtime, and during the runtime, you have a pointer, you follow the pointer, you find the object, and from within the object, you ask the object, what are you? Are you a shape? Are you a circle? Are you a triangle? And the shape itself says that, okay, I'm a triangle, and it finds the triangle's area and it calls it. So this decision is made during the runtime, not during the compile time. So this is not a simple, innocent code. There is something complicated going on underneath, since these are virtual. Okay, I say that P points to a shape object, but shape object could be the base class shape or the derived class anything, and I don't know what classes are going to be derived from this. Base shape class, okay? You're gonna know it during the runtime. When I call you with these kind of pointers, shape pointers, every time you execute this line, okay, this area could be a different function. That's why we call it polymorphism. What was the meaning of polymorphism? Polymorphism meant associating many meanings to one function, okay? That area function takes different meanings depending on the runtime value of that P pointer. Okay? Depending on the runtime value of that P pointer. That's why we call it polymorphism. That's why this is a reusable code. Why? I have written it, I have compiled it, and I have a .o file, okay? Without changing anything in my .o file, okay, without even recompiling it, I can use it with any other class that is derived from the shape.h. Okay, so this is called polymorphism. And again, we are not doing polymorphism just because it has a nice name. We are doing polymorphism to be able to write reusable code. That's why you are taking this course. Okay, we are after reusability. And again, as I said, this is a very reusable code, and we are gonna write these kind of code over and over again. As I said previously, polymorphism is one of the most frequently used features of the object-oriented programming languages. Okay? Understand by that? You understand why we need this keyword? We need this keyword so that you are telling the compiler that be careful about this line. Okay? This is not going to be decided during the compile time. This is going to be decided during the runtime. This is going to be decided dynamically, okay? Dynamic binding, or late binding. We have been doing early binding so far, okay? We have been doing early binding. During the compile time, we make our decision, we say that, you are going to call this function, so the compiler produces that code, okay? It knows which function to call, okay? When you link it, it knows it, okay? But now when you say area is a virtual function, its meaning is going to be decided during the runtime. And its meaning depends on this pointer, okay? Well, its pointer is a shape pointer. That doesn't mean that you're going to call this area. No, it means that it's a shape pointer. That means that it is either a base class object it is pointing to, or it might point to a derived class object. It might be pointing to a circle object, or a triangle object, or a rectangle object. We don't know. When are we going to know it? We are going to know it during the runtime, while I am executing this. This means that dynamic binding is more complicated, also less efficient, right? During the runtime, every time I execute one loop of this iteration, I should make a new decision. It is not as simple as making a call. It is, what is your object type? You ask this object. It says that I am a shape object, but I am an object derived from the shape class. I am circle. So where is your area? My area is here. So I am calling it. So there is a little bit complicated procedure going on with this line of code. Every time I need to make a new decision. That's why every time I take a new meaning, which is called polymorphism. Okay, so let me take 5 or 10 questions now. Okay, the first one, yeah.
Why do we need virtual? It works anyway, right?
No. If we don't say virtual, this code will always call this area. Okay? That's a very good question. Okay? If you don't say virtual here, this code is early binded. Okay? It's not dynamic, it's static. It will always call this one, it will return -1.0.
Shouldn't it just follow the pointer and then go to the...
That's what you think, that's the logical part? No, the compiler says that. This is what, I mean, compiler cannot know that you are going to derive another shape class from this one, and you are going to redefine it, and that kind of, compiler cannot know that, right? This is how you are telling the compiler that this is virtual. I will derive new classes from that, okay? And from those classes, I will redefine these functions, and you are going to make which function to call during the runtime. That's what you are saying. If you don't put these virtuals in there, all the decisions will be static. All the decisions will be, remember when I compile this one. I compile this with the shape class, and it is inside this shape at all. I didn't have the circle yet. Okay? You are telling the compiler that make this decision later during the runtime, not during the compile time.
So if you derive another function, another class from circle, for example, ellipses, you need to put virtual in those.
Well, actually, yes. This one is a virtual function too, but you don't have to say it's virtual because in the base class it's virtual. Now this one is virtual too. You cannot make it non-virtual.
They're in different parts of memory, right?
They are, sure, yeah. Well, I mean, this function is different, yes. They are different. Okay, yes.
So let's say we have a triangle class, but we have many types of triangles. So we don't need to put virtual in front of the triangle area to derive.
Well, I mean, if you have the right triangle and if the equilateral triangle and that kind of stuff, you make a base class triangle and you derive all the other triangles from there, but you don't redefine your area.
Like they say in the triangle, there's an area, but it's derived from the shape. So if the shape's area is virtual, do we need to put virtual in there?
No. Once a function is virtual in the base class, it is always virtual in the derived classes.
So
you cannot make it non-virtual.
How many classes we derive from it, it's always virtual.
Yes, true, yeah. That's the rule, yes.
Wouldn't it be better to put virtual in the derived classes to make readability better?
Yes, sure, yeah. Mm-hmm. That's a good idea. Yes. Well, I mean, we have a better solution than that, and we are going to come in. C++11 says that, yes. C++11 says that you need to indicate, yeah. Mm-hmm. We'll come to that. Okay, good. I mean, saying the virtual is not that good idea. I mean, saying that I am overriding this is a better idea. Yes. Say it again louder.
In shape class CPP.
Yeah, you mean this one, right?
Yes. Do auto keyword has to determine what is the shape of part P?
No. Well, I mean, I have written this auto. I have written this auto. Well, what is the type of auto? Okay, maybe that's a good point. let me okay, this should be shape pointer, okay? Because V, the elements of V is shape pointers, okay? Auto is not that smart enough to, I can understand. So the type of P is, I know type of P. Type of P is a shape pointer, I know. But I don't know what kind of object P is pointing to. It could be a shape object, or it could be a circle. I don't know. I mean, anything that is derived from shape class, okay? In fact, let me do this. What is the meaning of this function and this function? I don't like those. I hate them. I erase them. Okay. I mean, there is no point implementing these, right? There is no point implementing these. So I do this. I am not going to implement these. Okay. Now these are pure virtual functions. These are all pure virtual functions. And I'm telling the compiler that I am not going to implement these. Okay, these are virtual, pure virtual. They are not implementable. I am not going to implement them. So my intention is derive from this shape class later, and I will provide the implementations later. But when I make this pure virtual, this shape class becomes an abstract class. What do I mean by abstract class? We have never seen anything like this before. Abstract class means that it has at least one pure virtual function in it, and you cannot make objects of this class anymore shape. So when I do this, when I say this, this will give me a compiler error, because since it has functions, if I say shape s1.area, it is not implemented, right? What does the compiler supposed to do? That's a problem. So I shouldn't make objects of this shape class, but still, this is a compilable code. This one is compilable. Why? Because this doesn't make any shape objects. It just uses the shape pointers. Abstract classes can have references and can have pointers too. Okay. And in fact, most of the time, polymorphism is used with these kind of abstract base classes. Okay? Abstract base class means that, as the name implies, it is abstract, it's not concrete. Okay? You cannot make objects of it. So why do you need a class that you cannot make objects? Why do you need a class that you cannot instantiate? I need it because I need to make it a base class. Okay? Put all the common features of a number of classes together. And some of them are not implementable, those functions. Yes, I am not going to implement them anyway. Okay, later when I derive from them, they will be meaningful. And the nice thing is that this is a very abstract function, but it's a very reusable abstract function, actually. Okay, again, this one and this one is compilable. But this code will not be compilable anymore. Why? Because I cannot make objects of the shape class. And similarly, I cannot say shape S1, S2, S3. But again, it is possible to say pointer of S1, pointer of a shape, okay? Pointer of a shape, I can say that. Okay, good. Okay, I had only 3 questions now. I need 7 more. Again, simple syntax-wise, I didn't say much. I only told you that this is going to be virtual. Not much. I mean, for the whole inheritance chapter, I didn't introduce you many new syntax ways of doing this stuff. We already said that only the public base class name, that's it, and protected keyword. Now I have another keyword, virtual, and the pure virtual. Okay? So you look so confused. If you are confused and if you are not asking any questions, I don't know what to do. I can repeat the whole thing again, or you can go home and watch my video. Okay, you ask me a question. Don't take your eyes from me. Just. Ask me a question, yeah. What is your name? Ayşe. Okay. Did you understand anything? Everything? Doesn't make much sense? It doesn't make much sense, right? Does it? Okay, he's saving you. Yeah, okay.
How does compiler follow virtual functions?
You mean the question that is asked here?
No.
What do you mean follows?
Like, since there is a virtual function in this function.
Yeah.
But there is
lots of non-virtual functions.
There is virtual functions in the derived classes too.
Yeah.
But compiler knows which most derived virtual function needs to be called.
When you look at this line, okay, compiler knows that area is a virtual function by it looks at the because P, what is the type of P? Shape pointer, right? It goes to the shape class and looks at the area function. It's a virtual. So compiler says that I will not make a decision right now. I will produce code that will make that decision during the runtime. Okay? That's what it does. The code produced by the compiler does this. It takes this pointer. It follows the pointer, it finds the object, and it determines the object type. Once it figures out the object type, let's say it's a circle, it knows where the area of that circle is. It just calls it.
As far as I know, too, there is also virtual tables that...
When I say finds that function,
yeah.
it just scans that table. Yeah. And in fact, this when I say follows the object and finds it, it doesn't follow the object actually. It just asks the object, where is your virtual function table? And inside that virtual function table, it knows where all the virtual functions are for that class. Yes?
If circle class derived from tool class, is it still okay?
You mean the multiple inheritance?
Yes.
Well, if both of them defines this area function, that's the danger of the multiple inheritance. But if only one of them defines it, okay. To be able to make this work, okay, this P has to be the pointer of the base class, right? So if the circle derives from two base classes, one of them has to have a area function defined as virtual, okay? If two of them defines it, that's the bad part of the multiple inheritance. We have to deal with it. Okay, Ayşe, what is your question? Ayşe, what is your question? I will get back to you after that one. Yes.
When you said like when we use abstract classes, we can define objects for them, but we can define pointers or references.
Yes. No. There is no. You, yeah. No objects of abstract base classes, but references and pointers are okay.
Well, why would you really want to use that? Why would you define a pointer to an abstract class when it's not defining anything?
Well, otherwise I can't do that. How am I gonna write a function that takes an object? I cannot because there are no shape objects. But I should be able to write functions that takes base class pointers and base class references so that I can send them the right class objects.
So we can follow the direct class.
Sure. Yeah. Well, since there is an is that relationship, how did I make this call? This is a shape pointer vector, but I am pushing back a circle pointer, right? There is a relationship in there. That's how it works. Good. Any other questions? This is not complicated. This is simple. Okay. You just follow the rules. I mean, there are two things. The first thing is how do I do it? And I show you the mechanism. It says that in the base class, you define them as virtual. Okay. And if you like, you make them pure virtual. Okay, that's the mechanism, and you call it this way. The second thing is that why we are doing it? Why do we need it? We need it because I like to write reusable code. Look at this one. This one uses only shape pointers. It is as general as possible, right? This will work for all kinds of shapes, including triangles, rectangles, hexagonals, whatever new type of shape that you can come up with. Doesn't matter. So you cannot write any other code that is more general than this in terms of shape classes, right? So this is very, very general, very, very reusable code, okay? So that's what we are doing this. To be able to do this, some of the decisions has to be done during the runtime. So that's the downside. So during the runtime, we need to spend some more CPU time to make this decision of which area should I call. Yes.
Hocam, should we make an abstract class if not every function inside is virtual public function?
Well, sometimes, yeah, well, yeah, sometimes you are saying that if an abstract class is an abstract class, then all the functions should be pure virtual, you are saying, right? Sometimes, no. Sometimes, let's say I have a string name inside this shape, string name, okay? So I can write setters and getters for the shape name, right? So that makes sense. Not everything is abstract in an abstract-based class. Some of the things could be concrete. Some of the things are definable, and that would be useful. Remember our employee class? We couldn't write employee print check, right? It didn't make much sense. So maybe employee print check should be pure virtual, but all the other set name, get name, set SSN, get SSN, they are still meaningful. Okay? Not all abstract classes are very, very abstract. Java has a new way. Java says that if everything inside an abstract class is all abstract, it's all virtual, then we don't call them classes anymore. We call them interfaces. Remember the Java collection hierarchy? Can I show you that then again? Can I maybe connect? Java collections, am I connected? Oh, okay, surprised to connect it. So the images, okay, I think this is good enough. Okay, so these are the ones at the bottom. These are all concrete classes. They can be instantiated, okay? You may create these classes objects, no problem. These are abstract classes. That means that at least one method in them, in Java we don't call them functions, we call them methods. At least one method in them is pure virtual, okay? But these are very abstract classes. They did not implement anything, okay? Everything is abstract in them. Everything is virtual in them. Okay, pure virtual in them. We call them interfaces. Okay? And one of the rules of object-oriented programming design is this. Okay? Always code against interface. Write your code against the interface. Don't use, I have written my code here. My code uses the pure abstract class, nothing else, right? It uses abstract class. If you, in your code, if you use only interfaces or abstract classes, that means that you are writing code as general as possible, okay? You are not tied with concrete classes. You talk about abstract things, so you are as general as possible. So if you follow this one, if you are writing a code that uses this collection hierarchy, don't try to use this one or this one or this one. If it's possible, you try to use this one all the time. Because if your code depends only on iterable, then that means that anybody that uses your code is free to use any of these, right? So it is as general as possible. So always try to write your code against the interfaces, against the abstract classes, if it is possible. But sometimes you might say that, I mean, iterable is not powerful enough for me to write my code, so what are you going to do? Maybe this is okay, maybe this is okay. Sometimes, unfortunately, you have to come down to this, because you are dependent, you need to use some linked list features, okay? Okay, so if you find yourself in such a situation where you need to use one of these, then either you are making a mistake or you have to use it. Okay, good. Any other questions?
John,
yes.
When we are defining this virtual void row and we are setting it to zero.
Yeah. We are not setting it to zero, but it's just a syntax. It's just a way of telling the compiler that I am not going to implement.
It's just a way of telling it's a pure virtual.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Why didn't they just put pure virtual keyword?
Well, go 30 years ago and ask the Bjørn Strauss group why you didn't do that. Yes. I remember when I was a undergrad student like yourself, Dennis Ritchie was visiting Metu Ortodotechnik University, and people were asking him, why didn't you do this and this in while you are designing C? He said, I don't remember, what are you talking about? It has been like 40 years. And if Bjørn Strauss group remembers it, then in Java it is a little bit better. Java says that this function is abstract. Okay. By the way, Java all the methods are by default virtual. In Java, all the methods by default they are virtual. Java don't care about the runtime efficiency. Yes.
If these functions are some type of constants,
they are not constants. No. This is not equal or this is not assignment, okay? This is just a way of saying that this is a virtual function and I am not going to implement it. These are not implementable. There are no implementations of these. They are not constant, okay? You are putting too much meaning into this assignment or equality or whatever, okay? Read it differently. This is not assignment, okay?
What happens if I don't define pure virtual functions in my derivative class?
Well then, I'm asking that question back to you. If you redefine your pure virtual function inside this circle.h, circle becomes what? Circle becomes another. Any guesses? Another abstract class. You cannot make objects of circle. Okay? It might behave like a nice base class for the all other circle classes. Maybe like ellipse is a kind of a circle, but I don't know. I'm just making it up. But you would become another abstract class if you don't redefine it, if you override it. Good, that's a good question. Okay, any other questions? If there are no questions, maybe I should go back to the book slides and try to make sense of them for you. Okay, let's go back. And again, associating many meanings to one function so that I can write reusable code, okay? And virtual functions provide this capability. Runtime decision of what to call, okay? So far, we have been doing early binding all the time. Whenever we compile code, compiler knows which function to call, okay? But now we are using late binding. Late binding is only possible with the virtual functions, and virtual functions are only possible with the base classes and derived classes. In my base class, I have a function f, which is virtual, and in derived class, if I am redefining it or overriding this function, okay, then anybody calling this function with a pointer to the base class, for example, A is a base class, B and C are the derived classes. If I am using an A pointer to call this function f, then compiler makes this decision later. Okay, that's called this late binding during the runtime. Okay, good. So this is what the book says, and I like to point that out. Figures example, I already showed you what it is. I am not going to talk much about figures. My example is better than book's example, and again, virtual functions, okay? Tell the compiler, don't know how the function is implemented. Wait until it is used in the program. Wait until it is used in the executing program. So the executing program makes that decision, okay? This is late binding or dynamic binding. In C++, to do late binding or dynamic binding, you need virtual functions, you need hierarchy, you need base class, and you need derived classes, okay? By the way, in C++, polymorphism is only possible through the pointers to the base class or through the references to the base class. Either base class pointer or base class reference, one of them. Otherwise, everything is static. Everything is static, okay? When I say, let's say my shape class is not abstract class, I have implemented those stupid functions, okay? Let's say shape S1. Okay, when you say S1.area, this is definitely static. This is decided on the compile time because I did not use the base class pointer or base class reference. Okay, a function, if a function is virtual, that doesn't mean that it is always treated as virtual. To make a polymorphic call, it has to be either through a pointer to the base class or a reference to the base class. Okay, so there is another example in the book that talks about these polymorphism. Another example that I don't like much, but since the book talks about it, maybe it's a good example as a second example. We are going to look at it after we take 10 minutes of break. But before the break, maybe I can take another question. Any other questions? Okay, you look so confused. I don't know what to do. Okay, so yeah.
If you have a hierarchy for more than one abstract class, is it like, let's say we define a vector of pointers, let's say a shape, but we have another shape and it has like another set of shapes. So if we define the pointers of this shape, we cannot access like the other shapes, right? So
what do you mean? I mean, aren't they coming from the same base class if they are all shape?
Like, let's say in the Java hierarchy.
Yeah, but they are coming from the same. They are coming from the same root, right? Same base.
Yeah. So to use all the other abstract classes, we have to define a pointer to iterable, right?
Yeah. So if you write your code using the iterable interface only, you cannot do any better than that in terms of general code writing, reusable code. Yeah.
Let's say we have a vector of just few pointers, we cannot access the set and the list, right?
If you are using pointers of what?
Just
a Q one, yeah. So your code is only will be available to this hierarchy only. So your code is only as general as this hierarchy, this sub hierarchy here. That's why we say that try to write as general as possible, try to write to the top. In Java, you know what? In Java, by default, whatever you do, everything has to come from this class object. There is a class named object in Java. Okay? Everything has to come from this object. You cannot do anything else. Okay? So, in Java, if you are writing code against this object class, that means that this is as general as possible. You cannot do anything better than that. Object class, Java's object class and C's void pointer are very similar. C void pointer is a pointer that can behave anything, right? Any other pointer, right? Casting to void, casting from void is possible, right? If somebody expects a void pointer, you can send them any kind of address. So this is if you have a function that takes a void pointer, it is as general as possible, right? It is difficult to write those kind of functions, but again, it is a very general, very reusable code for them. So Java doesn't have any pointers, but it has this object class. Whatever you write, it has to derive from this object class. Okay, good. So we will talk about Java later. And talking about Java later, it helps me a lot in many ways. First, I am teaching you another language, but it will let me talk about object-oriented principles in another language, and that will make my job easier. Okay, good. 10 minutes of break. After that, we will continue. And go drink some coffee or something, or wash your face. Okay? I need questions. Yani inheritance yerine bazıları composition'ı daha sık kullanın derler, evet. Yani inheritance'a bağladığın zaman kendini, tamam mı? Ben bu sınıfa bağlayayım diye kendini bağlıyorsun. Ben bu sınıfa bağlayayım diyorsun. Ama composition olduğu zaman daha dinamik. Runtime'da daha iyi numaralar çevirebiliyorsun.
Böyle bir gerçek var
yani. Hiçbir şey gerçek diye bir şey yok. Farkında değil misin sen ya?
Hayır yani.
Yani bizim yaptığımız şey, her şey şuranın içinde küçük bir çifte. Gerçekle otobüslerle, ağaçlarla falan alakamız yok bizim. Biz uçuyoruz.
Yok yani.
Var yani, dayandığı noktalar var. Bazıları evet öyle söylüyor. Yani object oriented tasarım dersini aldığınız zaman
Onun hakkında bir şeyler söyleyecek. İleride zavallı dayanırmayın kendisi. Ama yeter. Şimdi ne dedim ben şimdi yazabildiği kadar abstrak klaslara karşı yazıyor bunu değil mi?
Evet.
Her şeyin abstrak klaslar oluşuyorsa çalışan kim? Birilerinin çalışması lazım değil mi? Bir yerde ayağını yerine dokunması lazım. İleride zaten kaçamazsın. Bir yerde dokunacaksan oraya gidiyor.
Ben sana dedim ki bir şey yemeyeyim. Yemekten çıkarken dedim ki atmayı unutma seni tamamlayacağım.
Atma bile geldi ki balık düzenleyecek mi de çevirecek mi? Teker teker
dedi.
C++'ı komite geliştiriyor değil mi? C++ komitesini bu işten seni kullanıyorlar.
Evet. Ama yani kaynakta çok elimin altında ağır elimde. Profesör veri kitabını da başının yazarını
İyi, donmamış değil mi? İyi, güzel. Evet.
C'de nasıl bir reusable kod yazıyorlar? Yoksa hep aynı şey fonksiyonlar?
Dünyanın en reusable koduna C'ciler yazarlardı. Size Quicksort anlatmadılar mı? Quicksort'tan daha reusable kod var mı? Quicksort anlatmadılar mı size? Siz bakmadınız mı? Quicksort neyi sıralayabiliyor? Quicksort neyi sıralayabiliyor? Hah. Bundan daha iyi yazılımı yazabilir misin? Adam bilmiyor. Tamam mı? Dizinin ne olduğunu bilmiyor. Dizinin elemanları nasıl şey yapacağını bilmiyor. Compare edeceğini. Değil mi? Kaç tane eleman var onu da bilmiyor. Her şeyini veriyorsun. İşte ne? Void pointer'larla yapmış.
Hayır. Void pointer'ı kullanarak şey yapıyor.
Evet. Tabi void pointer olduğu zaman type checking yok. Type checking olmadığı için de yani her şey seni kuvvetli ama bir hata yaptığı zaman kalıyorsun ortada. Yani pointer ilgilenmek kolay değil. Object oriented değiller. Bu reusable kod yazmayı type safe. Yani diyorsun ki yani ben hani şimdi bu void pointer'dan başka elinde bir şey yok C'nin. Sınırlanmaya çalış. Iterable değil de ben Q interface'ine karşı yazmak istediğim zaman yok öyle bir şey yok. Her şey void pointer üzerinden olmak zorunda. Tamam. Yani C kadar reusable kod yazabileceğim bir dil yok tabii. Evet, yine hazırladım. Göndermeyi unuttum ya. Bu akşama hazır olur inşallah. İki tane daha C++ ödeviniz var. 5 ve 6. 7 ve 8 Java olacak.
C++ ödevleri aynı bazı mı?
Olmasın mı?
Ha.
Ya yok ama yani şu dynamic falan filan vereceğim ya sizin için daha iyi olur. Eskisini çevirirsiniz ya da eskiden yapamayanlar bir daha baştan onu yapma fırsatı falan bulur diye. Okay, time is up I guess. Let's go back and continue talking about polymorphism. Okay. Let's go to the book. Book has this example. Where is my book? Yeah, it's where it's book. This is chapter what? Okay, good. So the book gives this example of sail class. I have a class named sail. Okay. I have a product, I am selling it. Okay. For that product, I have the price. And for the price, I have the get price and set price, no problem. Constructors. But I have a virtual function named bill. Bill is this. Bill is this. When I sell this product, what kind of money should I pay to this product? So what should I put as a value to the bill, to fatura? Okay? Because sometimes I might, usually the bill amount is the same as the price, right? For the simple cases, bill amount is the same as the price. But if I have a discount sale, the bill amount changes. Okay, so let's look at this sale class. As you see, this is a virtual class. And there is a savings function that takes a sale object as a reference. So that means that somebody is going to send me a sale object. It could be either the sale object or something that is derived from this class. And we're going to look at it. And there is a global operator, less than. It compares two sale objects. And it takes reference again. Okay? When I look at this picture here, I am immediately thinking that somebody is going to derive from this class. They will override this function bill, and they will try to compare sale objects, but those sale objects could be references to the sale class or the derived class objects. Okay, again, the savings is the same thing again. Okay, let's look at the implementation. Implementation is so simple. Namespace service sale, intentionally empty, price error check, and that's it. Bill, as you see, I did not write anything virtual in it during the implementation. I don't have to. But bill is the same as price. So I am returning the price. So this is a product that I don't do any discounts or I don't add any taxes. Okay. Bill, get price is the same thing. Set price again, error check. And savings is this. Is this a polymorphic call? Bill is a virtual function, and I am calling bill through the reference of the base class, right? Yes, this is a virtual function call. This is virtual. And this will be decided during the runtime. Okay? This will be decided during the runtime. Okay? Good? And we need to be careful about this one. So I expect that this sale could be a sale object or any other object that is derived from the sale base class. Okay, and this one, sale first and sale second. Again, base class reference. Okay, and first bill and second bill. Again, these two are going to be decided during the runtime. These are late binding calls. So in this 50 lines of code, I will have 1, 2, 3 function calls that will be made during the runtime. Okay? I compile this. I store this somewhere. Okay? Now I will write another class, which will be called discount sale. Okay? Discount sale. Discount sale says that I am a sale object. I am a sale class. Okay? But on top of it, other than my price, I will have the discount amount. Ne kadar indirim yapacağım? %10, %5, etc. Discount sale. And the discount sale says that I need the price and I need the discount. Okay. Get discount, set discount, of course. And this one is a redefinition or for the virtual. Remember, when we redefine a function from the base class, we call it redefinition. But if you are doing the redefinition for a virtual function, it is called overriding. Overriding. Overriding is a special version of redefinition. It is only done for the virtual functions. That's the common terminology people use. Okay? So I am going to override this one. The rest of them will be the same. And there's a discount. Okay, let's look at the implementation of this simple class discount sale. Discount sale, of course, I call the base class constructor, and discount is set to 0. And the two parameter one, nicely I send this value to this one, and I send this to this one, no problem. Get discount, set discount are very straightforward. And this is the bill. Bill says that I will divide discount by 100, I will get the fraction. One minus fraction times get price would be my bill. So I am doing some discounting, okay. So I have overridden my base class virtual function. But by the way, my base class virtual function was not pure virtual. It made some sense for the base class to define that build function. Okay, so this is my second class. I can compile them. And I am writing a driver code right now. I have two objects, sale simple and discount sale discount. One of them is $10, okay? So it is bill amount will be $10. The other one is $11, but I am making 10% discount. So which one is cheaper to buy? Which one is cheaper to buy? The second one. Why? Because $11, if I make a $10, 10% discount, it's going to be $1.10. So the total price I'm going to pay for this one would be $9.90, right? So that one. So that means that that's mean that look at this one. Line number 17. It looks so simple, but very complicated stuff is happening in there, right? Why? Because the less than operator is overloaded. It takes two what? It takes two reference to the base class, right? And simple is a base class object. It's okay. Discount is not a discount, is a discount sale object, but since there is an is a relationship, I can send it to that way. Okay. So I will send it that way. And this operator less than takes these two objects as base class references, and it will make two polymorphic function calls. Okay, when I make this call, this is the first one will be a sale object. The compiler, the code will go find the object itself and ask it, what are you? It will say that I have a sale object, and it will call the base classes bill. The second one will be the discount object. Okay, and it will tell that my bill is here, it is discounted. So it will return another number. The first one will return 10. The second one will return 990. And this if statement will say that, oh, okay, just I said the opposite. This one will return 990 and this one will return 10. And this if statement say that, okay, it is true. So in this case, I will get, okay, discounted item is cheaper. Saving is simple.saving. Simple.saving a virtual a polymorphic call? Simple.saving? Is this polymorphic? No. By looking at this, no. Why? Because simple is an object. Okay, it's an object name. Object name dot something is definitely an early binding. Okay, it's not polymorphic. That's one thing. The second thing is savings, the function name savings is not a virtual function, okay? So this is early bound, okay? This is early bound. But inside the savings function, let's go to savings, simple.savings, let's go to savings function. Where is my savings function? It's here. Savings says that I will take a sale object, okay? In this case, my sale object is a discount object. I call this bill function. Bill is a virtual function, and other is a reference to the base class, so this is a virtual function call. Okay? So the write function will be called. And bill will return $10. The other one will return $9.90. So the savings will be 10 cents. Okay? Savings will be 10 cents. Okay, here it is.
So is it a virtual function call or not?
Which one?
Savings.
Savings?
Savings not, but inside it is.
Sure, yeah. What was the conditions for the virtual functions, the polymorphism to happen? It has to be, the function has to be a virtual function. Saving is not a virtual function. Even if it's a virtual function, since I am calling it through an object name, this is definitely a static binding. It's not late binding. Okay? Ayşe, I am not going to ask you a question. Don't worry. But since I know your name, I will time to time come back to you. And I know where you are. You cannot hide me. Okay? Good. So another example. This time I did not use any pointers to the base class, but I used the references to the base class. The code from the book, I don't like these examples. My figures example or shape examples is much better. I mean, it's more. I mean, when you look at this one, I mean, you may understand the mechanism of using the virtual functions and the polymorphism, etc., but doesn't make much sense. Why should I use this thing? And it's so simple. I mean, why polymorphism is so important? I mean, I could have done this using some other method too, but remember what I showed you before. I showed you the total area thing, or remember the example that I gave you before. The example that I gave you about the operating systems. What did I tell you before? I said that all the Windows applications, if you are writing a Windows application, a program to run on your Windows system, it has to come from the standard base class. And this base class is an abstract base class because it defines some pure virtual functions. Okay? If you write your own application, Windows application, let's say it's a calculator, you have to provide these function definitions, the close function definition. Okay? How do I close your application or redraw or resize? Okay? I have to know about those to make it run on my operating system. Okay? So these kind of things are provided. You provide this kind of definition and you say that I am now Windows application, and Windows know that your close is working. So before shutting down the whole computer, Windows calls this function. It takes a WinApp pointer vector. Okay, for each pointer it calls its close function, and each one is a different one. Okay, for how many applications I am running now? In my computer, I am running how many applications? Where is my okay, app history, is that performance? Where are my applications? I think these are all applications. Yeah, Google Chrome and Hesap Makinesi. Do I have it? Yeah, Hesap Makinesi, Cartona, Posta. These are all my applications, and there are many of them. Okay, there are many of them. If I shut down my computer, if I do this, and if I hit this shutdown button here, the Windows operating system will run this loop. For each application, because it has the pointer for each application, it will make this close function call, and each application knows how to run the close by themselves. Some of them will immediately close, some of them will tell me that you did not save this file, should I save it? Okay, after that, Windows will safely shut down my computer. Okay, as I said before, this code did not change for the last 40 years, but this is reused for maybe tens of maybe hundreds of thousands of applications. Okay, so you cannot do any better than that in terms of code reusability. Good. Okay, so since I looked at the books example, let me go back to the slides. Okay, and we talked about this. Maybe it is important to know this term, run type type information, RTTI. Okay, RTTI. Do I get a definition for this one? for polymorphism to happen, each object should know its type, right? In C++, when you ask the object what is your type, it should know it. Otherwise, how am I going to know what type it is, and how am I going to find its area function, etc. But since each object knows its type, that means that I need to store the type information inside the object. So the compiler produces code about that information. Each object contains information about its type information. Okay? That means there is an overhead. My objects are becoming bigger. If you like, you can eliminate this by preventing this GCC, G++, I don't know. Can I find my, let me turn to this one. Okay. RTTI. I couldn't find it. Maybe. Okay. G++. RTTI. Okay. Runtime type information. Couldn't find it. There is an option somewhere in the G++ compiler to turn off runtime type information. Okay? So that would eliminate any polymorphic code, but it will make your objects a little bit smaller, object sizes. Because now your object doesn't have to know their types. Okay? So that's what I said here. Runtime type information, just keep this term. It doesn't, the book doesn't tell you anything about this, but okay, what else? So I have this sale class, I have this virtual function, I have this sale object. When I say, see, this is an early binding example. S.bill is early bound. Why? Because I am not using a base class pointer or base class reference. Okay, this is early bound. But if I do this, a sale pointer, address of S, or sale reference, okay, reference to an S, this one and this one will be decided during the runtime. This is early, and these two are runtime. Compiler cannot know which function to call, because compiler will think that maybe this guy will drive a new class later, after the compilation of this code. And maybe I will get another object type, and P maybe will point to that one. Okay, good. So I looked at already these, and the virtual is used in the declaration of the function bill. And see, this one is important. I think I had a question about this. Later derived classes of sale can define their versions of function bill. Okay, that's what we do. That of course they are still virtual, but I am redefining it, overriding it. Okay, so when I these three are related again. Overriding is a special version of redefinition, and these two are related to inheritance. This is definitely about polymorphism. This is definitely about inheritance. If you redefine a function that inherited from the base class, you are redefining it, but if you are doing it for the virtual function, it's called overriding. Overloading is completely different. For overriding and redefinition, signatures has to be the same, but for overloading, signatures has to be different. Good. So we looked at this one. I am going to skip it. I should not miss anything. We talked about this and the less than operator and virtual. So it looks like something, something magic. Okay. How did the compiler know which function to call? Of course, it is done using, Oh, see, I found it. No RTTI. How come I didn't find it? Maybe I used the capital letters. Is that what happened? RTTI. RTTI. Yeah. See, no RTTI there. No runtime type information. Let me find the next one. Disable generation of information about every class with virtual functions for use by the C++ runtime type identification features. Okay? Dynamic casting or type IDing, we will talk about those. So if you don't like it, just turn off runtime type information. Good. See, I wasn't crazy. There is such a thing. So with the virtual functions, this is what happens. Let's say I have my rectangle class that I have derived from the base shape class. Okay, each rectangle object keeps a pointer to a table, a virtual function table. That virtual function table holds pointers to the virtual functions of that class. For the shape hierarchy, I have the draw, I have the area, I have the perimeter, okay, etc. So I make a small search inside that table and I find my function pointer and I call it. That's what happens when I make a polymorphic function call. Okay? Late binding is this. Mechanism-wise, late binding is this. Okay, again, very important object-oriented principle. Of course, late binding comes with, is flexible, it's very, so nice, but it is expensive during the runtime. So we need to be careful about when to use late binding. Sometimes it's useful, but if it is not useful, then don't use it. Okay, again, same thing. I have, how about this one? Let's look at this picture. I have a class A and I have a destructor. See, I put virtual at the beginning of the destructor name. This is important to know virtual destructor. Also, this is important to understand what virtual is. If I don't write virtual in here. Okay. Class hierarchy, class A, class B, no problem. If I make a new object, A object, and I delete A object with this pointer, no problem. If I make a new B object and delete the B pointer using the delete operator, no problem. How about this one? A new B object, but it is pointed by an A pointer. If I delete this A pointer, what does the compiler think? The compiler will think that I am deleting an A object, right? But in fact, it is pointing to a B object. The compiler will call the wrong destructor, right? The compiler will call the wrong destructor. By making this destructor virtual, if I do this, the compiler will produce code that says that I will follow this pointer, I will find the object type, and I will call the destructor of that object type. Okay? So it is important to define your destructors as virtual in your base classes. Okay? Always start your base classes by writing a virtual destructor. Okay, so that if anybody deletes your object using this notation, which is common in many ways, okay, it will call the correct destructor. Okay, so it's called the virtual destructors. Again, if you are writing a destructor here, you are overriding your. You are not overriding your destructor because you are writing your own destructor. I think this slide was about overriding and redefinition, but I introduced this destructor here anyway. Okay, you understand? Okay, this is important. Defining your destructor virtual is important. You should always do that. But understanding why you need it helps you understand the idea of why we need virtuals and how they are useful. Okay, good. Any questions? Yes.
When we say like making the destructor virtual, but shouldn't the overridden functions have the same name? Like the destructor always follows the name of the class, so.
Yeah, but constructors are kind of the same thing. I mean, this is kind of an exception, right? I mean, virtual destructors and constructors are very specialized functions, and compilers behave. We don't call them, right? Somebody calls them for us. But when you say that, compiler knows that it's going to call a destructor, okay?
So it doesn't matter the name. It's going to go for the destructor of this object.
If the base class destructor is virtual, okay? The type of A is important to know to understand if the base class destructor is virtual or not. If the base class destructor is virtual, then the compiler says that I cannot make this decision during the compile time. I need to wait until the runtime to find what kind of object this one is. But in that case, the object was type A. Okay, I'm calling the type A destructor. In that case, the object was type B, and I'm calling the type B. How about this one? This one is I am calling the type A destructor because object type B destructor because object is of type B. I know.
So if A and B, or like both of them are class, base classes.
Yeah.
If we make
what B, do you mean? They cannot be both of them base class.
Like A is the base class for B, but B is the base class for other class for another class C, let's say.
Their hierarchies are different.
Yeah, no, the hierarchy is like A is at the top. Then yeah. We have B, then at the bottom we have
B. Oh, you mean there's a C?
Yeah.
You mean there is a class C, and this is a new C, is that?
Yeah, let's say it's a new C. So if we make the destructor virtual in A, is it going to be automatically virtual in B?
Sure. Yeah. Once you make a function virtual in the base class, all the derived classes will be virtual, and that includes. You are saying that since the destructor names are different, we are not overriding it, kind of. Yeah. But as I said before, the constructor and destructor are kind of special functions. We think them in a different way. That's a good point.
Should we always put virtual?
Make it a habit, okay? Always define your destructor as virtual.
I mean, all the virtual functions, I'm saying.
What?
If the function is virtual in the base class,
Should
they put virtual keyword in the derived class so that it's more readable?
I have a slide about that in a few minutes. But if you are designing a hierarchy, even if you are not designing a hierarchy, always define your base class destructor is virtual. Yes.
Let's say I have a container class, then is it better to put not virtual but put destructor and protect it? That way that may be lesser performance costs.
What do you mean? I mean, you don't want your derived classes to define their own virtuals, their own destructors? Yeah.
People can't deallocate or allocate my class, and therefore.
You are putting your constructor in the protected area.
Destructor. Yeah.
But in that case, people are going to make your objects, but they cannot destroy it.
Then I'm saying that if I'm making a container class for that I will make sure of the allocations and deallocations. Is it better to put protected instead of making it virtual?
Well, if you don't want other people to, I mean, if you don't want other people to make those kind of situations, then you should do something special with your constructors too. I mean, constructors are doing that. Usually when you try to hide your destructor, you should hide your other important functions like the constructors too. Hide them too and provide a static function for that class that produces new objects to make objects, okay? you do it through the static functions. That's called factory functions, actually, and that's another design pattern. Read the design pattern book, actually. That is a good explanation on that one. People, I mean, the question that you asked me during the break, some people, they don't like these constructors. They say don't use constructors. Use these kind of functions. Good? Okay. Again, the same question is this. I have this virtual double bell, okay, in the base class. This is virtual. Just to make sure that I know what I am doing, I do this. I am redefining this bell function, which was virtual in my base class, okay, by saying this keyword. I am overriding this. Override is a keyword, C++ keyword. You are saying that whatever I am doing is a redefinition, but it's a specialized redefinition. It's an overriding redefinition. Okay? Override keyword. If you put override keyword, and if this is not virtual, then you will get an error message saying that build is not a virtual. You cannot override it. Okay? This is different from, let's say I didn't write it here. I write here. When I say virtual double bill and I am overriding something, that doesn't mean that this bill is virtual in my base class. In your base class, this bill could have been non-virtual function. Now I make a decision that for the discount sale it's going to be virtual, right? It could mean both ways. It could be either in my base class this is virtual, I am virtual too, or it could be in my base class it was not virtual, I am making it virtual. Okay? But if I do it this way, it's much better. I am saying that I know a bill is virtual in my base, and I am overriding this. Override keyword.
So is it like just for readability?
For readability also, it's like using const, right? Using const. Okay. Good. So another new feature from C++ 11 is this final keyword. When you say, this is a virtual function, okay, I know this is a virtual function, but nobody can override this afterwards, after this class. After, if you derive from this class sale, you cannot override this. This is final, cannot override. Of course, this doesn't make much sense if the sale is the base class and it's virtual, right? I mean, if it's virtual and if you cannot override in the derived classes, why did you make it virtual? Okay, but it looks like base was a derived class from some other class. After sale, I don't want it to be overridden. In that case, I put a final keyword at the end. The final keyword. Okay, so these two new additions to the C++ 11 is not available with the previous versions. So be careful about them. Why? Because your compiler may not support them.
Hocam, when we are doing this in the derived class, are we writing virtual double bill const final or double bill const overridden final?
You mean this? After this one, if you do this, you are going to get a compiler error.
No. When we are using this final.
Yeah.
In the derived class, should we put this virtual keyword or overridden final?
Yeah, override final. Yeah, you should, that's a good idea. It is override and final. I am overriding the base class's virtual function, but if anybody derives from me, they are not allowed to override this anymore. Good. Any other questions? Okay. If virtual functions are so nice, why don't we use them all over? That's the idea of Java, actually. Java says that, okay, since they are so nice, everything is virtual. But in C++ and C, we are CPU time conscious. We don't want to waste our time for no reason. They are useful, but they are not useful for everything, okay? It's overhead. You need more storage. Every object has to know its type. Every object has to keep its virtual function table. If you have all the functions virtual in a class, then your virtual function table will be larger. We don't want that to happen. Okay, that's the memory problem. Maybe the more important problem is the CPU time, because every time you make a virtual function call, okay, the CPU has to spend some time to figure out which function to call during the runtime. Okay, during the runtime it's not good. During the compile time, I don't care. I mean, for the compiler, I can spend as much time as possible. I don't care because the servers are powerful. I compile my code on my server and send it to the customer. But if my code, produced code, is spending lots of time on my customer's computer, which might be that powerful, then that's a problem. So late binding is useful, but you should use it carefully. Okay, good. We talked about pure virtual functions. Pure virtual function means that I don't know how to implement this thing. Okay, I don't know how to implement this thing. Draw, I don't know. Or the area, I don't know. Perimeter, I don't know. So once you define a pure virtual function in your class becomes an abstract class. You cannot make objects of your class anymore. Opposite of abstract classes are the concrete classes, soyut sınıf, somut sınıf. Opposite of the abstract classes are the concrete classes. And so far we have been doing for the last 10 weeks, concrete classes. Okay, good. Our shape class in its final form, when we said equals zero, shape class was an abstract class. You cannot make objects of abstract class, but of course you could define references to the abstract classes. Also, you could define pointers to the abstract classes. Otherwise, you cannot write any code about them, right? Any code about them. So we came to a point where we have classes which we cannot instantiate. It looks meaningless, but the whole idea of object-oriented programming turns around this idea. Okay, to be able to code against the interface, to be able to write your code against the abstract-based classes, you need this kind of mechanism, okay? Abstract things, so that you don't tie yourself, you don't make any compromises, you don't make any promises about concrete implementations. You talk about abstract stuff, so you stay as general as possible, as abstract as possible. Okay? That's what we call pure virtual functions. Classes with one or more pure virtual functions are automatically abstract-based classes. Your question, if the derived class fails to define all pures, then it's an abstract-based class too. Okay, good. Again, I am going to return to the is a relationship. I know that shape is the base class. There is a relationship between circle and shape, triangle shape. Okay, derived is derived class of base. Okay, so derived objects can be assigned to objects of base, but not the other way. So if I can say that, like, let's say a function that takes a shape pointer could be called with a circle object. We know that. F address of C. We know that. There is a relationship. But not the other way. If a function is expecting a circle pointer, you cannot send a shape pointer or a triangle pointer. There is no is a relationship the other way. Okay? So this is called extended type compatibility. What do we call the type comp? What is the definition of type compatibility? If you are doing an assignment, A gets the value of B, or if you are calling a function with this one, the types of A and B should be the same, right? Type compatibility, or the type of A should be the same as the type of the function f parameter. That's the type compatibility. But with the inheritance and is a relationship, there is this extended type compatibility. Type of C is not shape pointer, but it's a circle pointer. But since there is a relationship between them, I can make this. This is called extended type compatibility. Okay? And this is perfectly valid. It is desired. I have this example from the book again. Let's say, for the sake of simplicity, I am going to ignore all the private, public stuff, kind of. I have a class named Pet, Evcil Hayvan Pet, and each pet has a name, and I have a virtual void print const. It prints the name of the pet. And I have this dog class that derives from the pet class. Since dogs are pets, no problem. But dogs are specialized pets. Why? Because they have their breeds, cinsleri, köpek cinsi, right? And that's it. So let's do some stuff in here. Let's do this. Yeah, okay. I have a pet, P, and I have a dog, D. P is here. Its name is written here. I guess its name is Boncuk, right? And I have a D. Okay. D, since D is a pet, it should have a name. Its name is Alash, and its breed is Kangal. As you know, all Kangal dogs should have a name of Alash. Anybody from Sivas here? Yeah. Sivas, adın Muhammed mi senin? Nasıl Muhammed? Yani herkesin adı Muhammed de burada. Okay. You know this, right? All the Kangal dogs are... No? Karabaş is a... What do you... Okay. You are not from Sivas. Okay. Did you see that guy on YouTube? I guess he was calling his dogs to Kangal dogs from 4 kilometers, and they were finding me in like 10 minutes. Did you see that? 5 of them. Just watch that one. Okay. I think it was real. So I have this P and I have this D. Okay. Look at this one. If I make this assignment, P gets the value of D. Can I make this assignment? P is pet, D is dog. Since there is an is a relationship, I can make this assignment, but this is not possible. All dogs are pets, but not all pets are dogs. Okay? I can make this assignment, but I cannot make this assignment. But if I make this assignment, what happens? I copy Alash name to Boncuk name, right? I mean, I copy the name. What happened to this breed, Kangal? I cannot put anything. I mean, this Kangal has to be ignored because there is no place to put Kangal in here, right? So this is called slicing problem. Okay? Slicing problem. I have to slice my object into some smaller parts, and I am able to only assign this part to this part, and I have to ignore the rest. Because this is a specialized object, this has extra information. I could make this assignment from this direction to this direction, but while I'm making this assignment, object assignment, I am losing some data, slicing problem. Okay? I am losing some data. But if I do the pointer assignment, I don't have that problem. With the pointer assignment, can I show you there? Let's do it that way then. Let me just erase this stuff. Okay. And let's say I have a dog pointer and I have a pet pointer. Okay. Pet pointer and dog pointer. Let's say pet pointer gets the value of P, dog pointer gets the value of D. So the dog pointer points to this, pet pointer points to this, right? So the question is this: can I write this? Pet pointer gets the value of dog pointer. Can I write this? All dog pointers are actually pet pointers. There is a relationship. So this is okay. This is okay. How about just the opposite? Can I write this? Dog pointer and pet pointer. Not all pet pointers are dog pointers, so I cannot write this. Not possible. So let's look at this picture. If I say PP gets the value of DP, so PP will point to, PP will point to this dog, right? Is there a slicing problem now? Why not? Because the name Alash and the breed Kangal is there, right? I did not change them. PP is pointing to a dog object, and I did not have this slicing problem. So if you slicing problem is there, you cannot avoid it if you do this kind of assignment. If you do this kind of assignment, but if you like to avoid it, don't use object assignments. Use pointer assignments. That's why we kept taking pointers of shape, vectors of shape pointers, right? We did not take vectors of shapes. Okay, we take vectors of shape pointers. We didn't have any slicing problem in our previous examples. I was trying to be careful about pointers. Okay, again, the same thing with the references. If a function takes a pet reference, you could send a pet to that function or a dog to that function. No slicing problem will occur. Okay, good. Any questions? Okay, that's it for today. Then on Monday, I think I will do the lecture on Monday. And I will continue this chapter. I will finish it up. And we will start the next chapter maybe. Okay? On Monday, I will do the lecture. Did everybody sign this one? Did everybody sign the attendance sheet? Thank you.